Welcome to Come Follow Me, Act in Doctrine with Mariana Richardson, Stephanie Dibb Sorensen, and our guest today is Heather Moore. Today we will be discussing Doctrine and Covenants, sections 30 through 36. Our doctrinal takeaways for this episode are: do not fear man, but rely on the Lord. Open your mouths and they shall be filled, and miracles have not ceased. It's great to be with you again, Mariana. And Heather, it's wonderful to have you join us.
Thank you. I'm excited to be here as well.
Great. Well, today we're going to be talking about Doctrine and Covenants sections 30 to 36. But before we jump into those sections, I just want to briefly state, isn't it amazing when we get the chance to hear from prophets and apostles, right?
Oh, it's so wonderful. And it's so fabulous to have that in our homes families.
Yeah, I am so looking forward to being able to study those talks as we go forward and apply them to our gospel study. So jumping into sections 30 through 36, we are going to learn a little bit about that. And Heather, why don't you start us off with some of the takeaways that you had from your study?
Okay. So one thing I love to do is when I'm looking at a set of scriptures is to kind of find out what the historical background is and what's going on during those few weeks or few months. So DNC 30, we're starting in September 1830, and then as we get up to 36, we're going into the future months. But we need to remember that Joseph had recently moved from Fayette, New York, and he was temporarily living with David Whitmer in his home. He had gone through several hardships. He and Emma had lost a baby, and if you remember that just before this, Martin Harris had lost those pages of the manuscript, and also he had been arrested and tried. Obviously, he got released, but the church is very young. It's only around 6 months old, and he now receives these revelations for missionary work, which, of course, I think really apply to our day-to-day. It applies to us in our homes and also missionaries out there in the mission field. The first thing I wanted just to bring up, and then we can discuss a little bit about him, is David Whitmer is in DNC 30. And we find that, so verse 1 is, "Behold, I say unto you, David, that you have feared man and have not relied on me for strength as you ought." And when I read this, I thought, oh my gosh, this is
all of us,
half of my life, right? So it's interesting that we do read rebukes in the Doctrine and Covenants. And maybe it might be a little embarrassing for the person getting that revelation, but we can really, really learn because we all go through these life trials together. And in verse 2, it says, "But your mind has been on the things of the earth more than the things of me, your maker." And that really struck me as well, because how many times do we go throughout our day, our week, our month, and we realize, wait a minute, you know, I was so rushed this morning, I didn't do, you know, scripture study or however we've structured our days. But then this section continues with some beautiful promises. So in verse 8, we read, "If we give heed unto these things and be diligent in keeping my commandments, and you shall be blessed unto eternal life," which of course is the pinnacle of what we hope for. And then in verse 11, "And your whole labor shall be in Zion with all your soul from henceforth, yea, you shall ever open your mouth in my cause, not fearing what man can do, for I am with you." And I know that these are some powerful missionary scriptures as well. I have a daughter that returned a few months ago from a mission. And you really do get that mantle. You really do get this blessing. But what about the rest of us when we don't have that mantle on us? We're not serving a full-time mission. I guess my question that I would love to discuss is we know it's so hard to open our mouths, but what are some of the fears and hesitations that have maybe held you back? And I was thinking about this a lot. And so I'm kind of an introvert. So just putting that out of the way, I think sometimes I think, well, what if they think I'm being pushy? Mm-hmm. Or what if they think the only reason I'm talking to them or being nice to them is I have an agenda to get them to come to church? And I remember when my husband and I were living in California, when our kids were little, I had a neighbor. We were very close friends. Our kids were the same age, play dates all the time. And I just had this impression that I needed to share for a Book of Mormon. I was so nervous about it because I thought, what if our friendship falls apart? Right. And I was praying about it, and finally, I just did it as a Christmas present with a note inside, because I was so shy, I guess, in that respect. And she was so appreciative. She knew she didn't convert to the church or anything. Of course, there's still time, yeah. But she just knew that it was important to me, and she was, I guess, impressed that I would share something so important with that was important to me with her.
She knew it was heartfelt.
Right. Yeah. So I'd love to hear from you and about your experiences.
Well, and I had a very similar experience, and yet it didn't have that happy of an ending. And it was interesting because I felt strongly that I was supposed mm-hmm. to share that. But the thought that came to me afterwards, because it was hard to be able to have that negative experience. But I also felt from the Lord afterwards that I don't know what's going to happen a decade from now yeah. or 15 years from now. The initial response was not positive, but that doesn't mean that that Book of Mormon in that home isn't going to be something that's going to be used years later. And so I think sometimes, too, we have that fear of, oh, no, it didn't turn out the way I was hoping. And so, I mean, you had such a wonderful experience. Sometimes we don't. Yeah. And yet we still have to have faith in the Lord and have trust in Him that eventually it will be a happy ending.
Yeah. One thing that can make it easier to be a missionary, even when we're afraid to open our mouth in a very inviting, bold kind of way, is just living the gospel very conspicuously. Mm-hmm. And last time you talked about not separating like our spiritual life from our daily life and just taking opportunities. I remember President Ukedorf in General Conference telling us, when you talk to people and tell them about your life and how was your day, you tell them, oh, well, I went to church or I read scriptures. And you can just bear testimony just by showing that the gospel is a part of your life and not being afraid to make that part of you such an obvious integration into how you present yourself.
So the next thing I want to discuss is Elizabeth Marsh, and she is mentioned in the Come Follow Me lesson. She had kind of an interesting conversion story. So her husband, Thomas B. Marsh, he brought back 16 pages of the Book of Mormon right as they were printed hot off the press. And she read only 16 pages of the Book of Mormon, and she felt the Spirit enough that she agreed to move to join the saints from Boston to Palmyra. And in fact, she hadn't yet agreed to be baptized, and it wasn't until later that she did. And I wanted to read this quote that is from the book Saints. Elizabeth's determination grew out of her conversion. Although she believed the Book of Mormon was the Word of God, she had not been baptized right away. After giving birth to a son in Palmyra, however, she asked the Lord for a witness that the gospel was true. A short time later, she received the testimony she sought and joined the church, unwilling to deny what she knew and ready to lend a hand to the work. There has been a great change taking place with me, both in body and mind, Elizabeth wrote, Thomas's sister, shortly before they left Ohio. I feel a desire to be thankful for what I have received and still look for more. This intrigued me because I watched this story as her testimony just grew bit by bit in small steps. And this will lead into when we talk about Orson Pratt a little bit later, is a lot of these members were brand new converts, but yet they're asked to do very, very hard things, take these huge leaps of faith. In fact, we could continue the story. We know that Elizabeth and her husband did fall away from the church eventually. They lost their 14-year-old son, and this was at a time when several members of the church were falling into apostasy, and they got swept up into that tide. So it really is kind of a cautionary tale as well. But instead of kind of focusing on that, I want to move into kind of the opportunities that we have, even if we feel like we don't know as much as someone else, or we haven't had a certain calling, or we don't have a background. Maybe we are a convert to the church, and we look around and we think they know so much. They have so many opportunities that I haven't had in my life yet. So this is a fun story. When we get to DNC 34, is we meet Orson Pratt. He was only 19 years old when he heard about the gospel from his brother, Parley P. Pratt. In fact, Orson, though, interesting, if you look into his history, he had been a very serious student of the scriptures, and he was seeking the truth. In fact, he reminds me a little bit of Joseph Smith in that way. He was asking and seeking, and he was baptized on his birthday, which is September 19th, and he was 19 years old. And within a few weeks of his baptism, as you know, this is like a short time period, he was asked to serve a mission by Joseph Smith. So in DNC 34, we read about the Lord's call to Orson. Blessed are ye because ye have believed, and more blessed are ye because ye are called of me to preach my gospel. So we hear this, and this is beautiful, but Orson later says what his feelings were when he heard this. He said, I thought that was a very great and important calling, and I felt altogether incompetent unless the Lord qualified me by his Spirit. So even when you're in this position where Joseph Smith is having this revelation about your call to be a missionary, Orson is still, he still recognizes that he cannot do it without the Spirit. So he goes to Colville, New York, and he fulfills this mission. He later said, I thought to myself that unless the Lord shall pour out his Spirit upon me more fully than anything I ever yet have experienced, I never can perform these duties acceptably in his sight. His final thought was, he felt oftentimes to tremble and shrink for fear he never should be able to fulfill and accomplish so great a work. So as we know, Orson went on to be an apostle for more than 60 years. And so we see these seeds and we see these hesitations and these fears. And like we talked about a little bit earlier, that we just don't know that sharing our testimony or sharing the Book of Mormon, how it may have long-term effects down the road. So I love to talk about maybe kind of just thinking about Orson. Have you ever been given an assignment or a calling where you felt like, this is so out of my scope of comfort?
Motherhood.
Right.
Oh, definitely.
For me.
But now looking back, you see the Lord's hand.
Oh, yeah. I mean, yeah, I see that any success I've had has been from his help. One thing that stood out to me while you were talking about Orson not seeing the seeds, is I think it's really interesting that not even considering whatever seeds he might have had from converts or people that he influenced, look at what he became. He was an apostle for 60 years. And just by being willing to do what the Lord was asking, it was preparing him to become what the Lord wanted him to be, regardless of how others reacted. I think that's kind of important.
Yep, I love that.
Well, I completely agree with all the points that you've made. And I think about when we were serving a mission in Brazil and some of the interesting things that we had with some of these missionaries. Many of them had a similar story to Orson in that they had just joined the church and then they were called to come and serve a mission. Mm-hmm. And so when these missionaries would come to our mission home, we had an opportunity to be able to talk to them, and many of them came with those fears. We had American missionaries who had never been in Brazil before, and for them, some of them had never left their homes before. And so here they are in a strange country. But we also had, most of them were Brazilian missionaries, and many of them, though, had lived in small towns, and they're coming to São Paulo, which is the largest city in North and South America. And so for them, this was also kind of a fearful time. And so I would read to them Doctrine and Covenants 33, verses 8 through 10, to be able to help them have courage, but also to help them understand what the Lord wanted from them. And it says, open your mouths, and they shall be filled, and you shall become even as Nephi of old, who journeyed from Jerusalem in the wilderness. Yea, open your mouths and spare not, and you shall be laden with sheaves upon your back, for lo, I am with you. Yea, open your mouths, and they shall be filled, saying, repent, repent, and prepare ye the way of the Lord, and make his path straight, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So I have a question for you. Why do you think the Lord uses Nephi to be the one that he puts as an example of open your mouth? Realize the Book of Mormon had been translated by this time, so he could have used Alma or Ammon or one of these other missionaries, but he picked Nephi.
I personally think it's because of the family dynamics. So we look at Ammon or Alma, and they were going out and being missionaries to people other than their families. But I think it would have been even harder for Nephi to open his mouth when he's in his family community. He has brothers that are have given him a lot of trouble, and he's the younger brother, so he's kind of the bottom of the pecking order. So I think that for Nephi, it was he had to overcome an extra hurdle of being in a family system that was very difficult.
And I think that speaks to this idea that you've already discussed about fear, that for him, because of those circumstances, the fear might have been greater. Mm-hmm. And so when the Lord's saying, be like Nephi, he's saying, don't worry about all of these things that might be holding you back, but just be bold the way that right. he was.
I also love the fact he says, who journeyed from Jerusalem in the wilderness. Mm-hmm. And so many of our missionaries are called to go to wildernesses, you know, right. to places that are very different from where they came from. I think of Jerusalem versus they went to a new land, a new world. Yeah. And for many of our missionaries, they are asked to do a very similar thing. Elder L. Tom Perry also gave a wonderful talk in General Conference where he quoted this scripture. And then he said, if we are asked to open our mouths three times, just like this scripture says, what would we say? And he gives us some ideas. He said, the first thing when you open your mouth, you should declare that Jesus is the Christ and declare about the atonement and his atonement. The second thing is to relate the first vision in your own words and your own testimony of the first vision. And the third thing, he said, when we open our mouths a third time, it should be to testify that the Book of Mormon is a book of scripture from the Lord. So as we think about these things, I also realize sometimes it's really hard for us as weak things, which we also read in section 35 here, that we are all weak things. And this is a hard, hard thing to always be on our missionary game. And I love the story of President Joe J. Christensen. He tells the story, and he told this about himself, which I think also tells what a wonderful, humble man that he's willing to tell this story. But he says when he was mission president in Mexico City, he had President and Sister Kimball in his car, and he was taking them back to their hotel. And he had to stop for gas. And as he's pumping gas, a woman comes up to him asking him to buy some gum, some chewing gum. And so he buys the gum from her, and she leaves, and he says, thank you. And then gently, President Kimball rolls down the window and says, President, don't you think you should tell her who we are? And immediately, President Christensen calls the woman back and introduces himself as the mission president of the area and introduces President Kimball as the president of the church. And he said, she left, but we had given the invitation to go and hear the gospel from the missionaries. And I love that story because I think oftentimes we could hear those gentle words from President Kimball in our own lives. Can't you just tell them who you are? Express who you are and what you believe to our friends, to our families, to our neighbors, to those that we meet, co-workers, those that we meet on the street. That is something that the Lord is asking all of us to do. I know you've already mentioned Ukdor's talk, yeah. which I just love. But one of the things that he does talk about that is he says, share what's in your heart.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that kind of goes along with that idea that we have the promise in Ether 12:37 that these weak things will become strong unto us if we have faith in the Lord. Mm-hmm. Now, we kind of get an understanding from Elder Perry about those three things that we should open our mouths about. But in this beginning of the Doctrine and Covenants, the Lord himself also tells us something that we should express as we do missionary work. And for me, it is a joyous thing that we can say, but it is also a humbling thing that we can say. And if we go back to Martin Harris, we love Martin Harris, but in section 19, the Lord is talking to Martin Harris and says, and speak freely to all, yea, preach, exhort, declare the truth, even with a loud voice, with the sound of rejoicing, crying, Hosanna, Hosanna, Blessed be the name of the Lord God. Then in our reading this time, if we go to what he said to Edward Partridge, he's talking to Edward Partridge in section 36. And he tells Edward that he should go out and teach the peaceable things of the kingdom. And then he says, and you shall declare it with a loud voice, saying, Hosanna, blessed be the name of the Most High God. And then in our reading that's going to be happening next week, he also says the same thing to James Coville. And he says to him, go forth, crying with a loud voice, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand, crying, Hosanna, blessed be the name of the Most High God. Now, Hosanna is taken from two Hebrew words put together, and we see it in the Psalms. Mm-hmm. But what it means is, save us now, we beseech thee. And so it is something that the Lord says we should say with rejoicing, with happiness in our hearts, that hope that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ will save us. But it is also a message for the world that we can bear testimony that the Savior will save us now. I was wondering if you've ever had that experience of being able to feel in your heart that shout of Hosanna to yourself or to others.
That brings to mind when we do a temple dedication and we're able to, with our white handkerchiefs, shout Hosanna. But I love this because this is just embodying how missionary work and sharing the gospel should make us feel. It is good news and it's joyous news, and it's literally bringing people unto Christ. I'm trying to think of a time when I have felt that. I think it's just being in the right place at the right time and feeling that my prayers are being answered, whether I'm in the temple praying or whether I'm at church or just on my knees at home. So I think that we can feel this Hosanna anytime that we are praying and seeking the answers that we need.
I think so too. The miracle of missionary work is pretty powerful. The fact that the Lord has asked these weak things to go out into the world and to declare this message, mm-hmm. I think for me that is a miracle.
Yeah, and I'm glad you brought up miracles, because that was for me one of the takeaways that really stood out to me from this section. If we look in section 35, starting in verse 7, the Lord says, it shall come to pass that there shall be a great work in the land. And we already know from previous sections that part of this work is the missionary work of the church going forth, the marvelous work and a wonder, starting with the restoration in the Book of Mormon and then the declaration of it. And he says, even among the Gentiles, for their folly and their abomination shall be made manifest in the eyes of all people. In verse 8, for I am God, and mine arm is not shortened, and I will show miracles, signs, and wonders unto all those who believe on my name. So even if we just stop right there and think about the fact that the Lord is promising that miracles will continue to be a characteristic of this restoration, which that's very, very exciting, right? Like, it's not just the knowledge that's being restored, but the power to do the work of God in miraculous ways. And then in verse 9, it says, and whoso shall ask it in my name in faith, they shall cast out devils, they shall heal the sick, they shall cause the blind to receive their sight, and the deaf to hear, and the dumb to speak, and the lame to walk. So we're talking full-scale miracles coming back into the earth because of that authority and power that's being restored. As I was studying and thinking about this, I came across a quote from Elder George Q. Cannon that he gave in November of 1880, so 50 years after the Restoration. And he said, many of this people, before they heard of the organization of the church, read the Acts and teachings of the apostles and of our Savior, and also Paul's epistles, and their souls yearned for a day of such power upon the earth. Many who are here today in 1880, right? Many thousands throughout this territory who are now connected with this church have wished that they could have lived at a time when these acts were being performed. But the history of the elders of this church, the miracles and manifestations of God's power which they have witnessed and have been the instruments in performing, would make a book far larger than any record we have handed down to us. Isn't that amazing? And I started thinking about that. I thought, isn't it interesting that in 1880, like when we study these doctrine and covenants and we study church history, we see miracle after miracle, like there's angels at the temple and beings coming down and all these things. And we're thinking, wow, look at all of these miracles. And then we say, but where are they today? And Elder Cannon is saying that in 1880, the saints were like, man, I wish we had lived in a time of miracles. And I think it's so interesting. Here he is testifying that there are miracles happening today. Why do you think it's so hard for us to recognize them?
You know, I think one of the reasons why it's hard to recognize them is we live in a day of miracles, and that if you think about, you know, television, smartphones, I can remember when we were in Brazil, it's when the whole smartphone craze happened. And I just had a little flip phone, you know, and then all of a sudden I come back to the United States and these smartphones can do everything. And so oftentimes we see these miracles that are miracles, but they're just kind of a part of life. And so I think we get desensitized.
The awe and wonder is commonplace. It's
exactly. And I think we need to bring back that awe and wonder.
Yeah, and I agree. I think we play it down. Like we have something amazing happen, an answer to our prayers or an obvious miracle, and then we start to justify or explain it away. Mm-hmm. Well, that would have happened anyway, or it happened because of this. And so that way we're not seeing the Lord's divine hand, even if we recognize at the beginning is we're not remembering it. So I think it's important to journal and to write down those, our spiritual experiences and the miracles that we see. So when we look back, we can, you know, remember the spirit that we felt.
You know, when you were just talking, a thought came into my mind that perhaps we falsely place a label of a miracle needs to be unique in order to really be a miracle, because we may think, well, yeah, God answered my prayer, but he answers everybody's prayer.
Right.
It's a miracle every time.
Oh, right. Definitely.
Right?
And we need to remember that.
Yeah. I've found a quote by Elder Donald L. Hallstrom, and he said, often we describe a miracle as being healed without a full explanation by medical science, or as avoiding catastrophic danger by heeding a clear prompting. However, defining miracle as a beneficial event brought about through divine power that mortals do not understand gives an expanded perspective into matters more eternal in nature. This definition also allows us to contemplate the vital role of faith in the recipient of a miracle. And so, just like you were saying, an answer to a prayer or a gentle prompting is a miracle because it is beneficial help from a divine source, and it helps us to do or understand something beyond our own capacity, right? Isn't that an amazing concept?
Yeah, that is an incredible definition, this idea of beneficial help. And just like you were saying, Heather, I think all too often when we see something beneficial come into our lives, we do just explain it away rather than saying, well, this very much is part of divine help in my life.
Yeah. Elder Bednar gave a devotional at Brigham Young University, and he talked about all of the miracles that have happened in the temples to help people receive temple ordinances and to help workers be able to assist people to receive those ordinances during the pandemic. And after he gave that talk, he reflected and shared some thoughts on social media. And I'm just going to share those, but I'm hoping that as we think about what he said, that maybe this can help formulate for us a little bit what our act and doctrine challenge might be today, because I think there's something really specific we can work on. Occasionally, I am asked by church members why we do not have mighty miracles today like those that occurred in the early days of the restoration of the church. My answer is always the same. We do. The day of miracles has not ceased. The mighty miracles in our lives are exactly the same today as they always have been for devoted disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. Making sacred covenants with God and receiving worthily priesthood ordinances, the fire of those holy covenants working on and within us and receiving the power of godliness in our lives as we honor those covenants and walk in all the ordinances of the Lord. We are blessed to live and serve in a most remarkable season of the dispensation of the fullness of times. I testify that no unhallowed hand and no pandemic can keep the Lord's holy work from progressing. And I promise that as you honor your covenants and strive to discern with an eye of faith, your spiritual vision will be magnified and refined to help you learn that the seemingly small miracles in your life will be the mightiest and most impactful of all. Isn't that an amazing challenge from him to think about? And before we kind of pull our real action item from that, I just want to point out one thing. The very last verse in the sections that we studied today, the Lord declares himself as Jesus Christ. This is section 36, verse 8. He says, I am Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Wherefore, gird up your loins, and I will suddenly come to my temple. Even so, amen. And Elder Bednar was specifically talking about the miracles that come through ordinances and even in the temple. And this is the very first time in the Doctrine and Covenants since we started from Joseph Smith history up until this section, this is the first time that the word temple appeared. And I just think that that's very exciting because the Lord is starting to lay the groundwork for the greatest blessings and power and miracles that can come into our lives. And he's going to do that by making temples and temple power available to us. And I just love that. I'm so excited. Like, I'm excited for the saints that to know what's coming and what's going to be available to them, because there will be a lot of bad that they're going to experience. But the Lord is giving them a temple to compensate them with blessings of eternity and power to face those
things. And that goes with Hosanna. And the Hosanna shout that we talked about, that we also say at the dedications of all the temples.
Yeah.
So I love having those two together.
Yeah. So, Act and Doctrine Challenge, as we were reading that quote and thinking about these things, what are your thoughts?
I love the idea of looking for the miracles in our lives.
That I agree.
For me, I think, and Heather, you were talking about writing them down and making sure we have a record of all of those things.
Yeah. Yeah, in fact, I think it was a few days ago, I was talking to someone and they said, oh, if you're a writer, you must write in your journal. And I had to say, not very much. So, but I love that. I feel like when I have like a big event, maybe, you know, a baptism in my family, I'll write about it. But I love the idea of just even daily, just even if it's on your phone, get out your notes and just write, what miracles are you seeing around you that day?
Yeah. President Eyring gave that talk called Oh, Remember, Remember, where he bore testimony of the fact that writing down every day some evidence of God's hand in his life. And I think that takes us back to that definition that it's a beneficial event from a divine source that helps us to accomplish more than we could on our own. So let's look for those this week in our lives, make record of those.
I'm looking forward to it.
and I'm sure that can help us to focus on a lot more joy and be able to sing Hosanna in our own hearts when we recognize his hand. Thank you so much for everything you brought to our discussions today.
Thank you.
Thank you.